Next speaker is Dr. Benno Graf from Memorial University of Newfoundland, decoding uncharted genomic variation in acute myeloid leukemia using long-read sequencing technology.
Okay, thank you, Nicola, for this presentation. Can all you guys see my screen?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so as you mentioned, my name is Toati Benno Graf. I am an assistant professor at Canada Research Chair in Bioinformatics for Personalized Medicines at the University of Memorial University in Newfoundland. And I am also a visiting assistant professor at the Cancer Science Institute of Singapore. So the work that I'm going to present you today, it's a work in collaboration with both universities, which involve people from Newfoundland and also people from Singapore. So most of this work actually has been done by my PhD student, Tam Chen Yong, so from Singapore. And this work actually also was taking over with one of our engineers here in Newfoundland named Geoff Woodlands. So what I'm going to show you today is how we can use the latest technology of sequencers, so we call the third generation of sequencers, to find novel structural variants which were not detectable with previous technology. So the first questions I want to ask you is, what is NGS? What means NGS? And most of the time, people will answer NGS means next generation sequencing. But next to what? And actually, it's next to the Sanger sequencing, which was the first generation of sequencer. So next generation sequencing is actually the second generation of sequencer. So what I'm going to talk today is the next generation of sequencer, which is the third generation of sequencer. So just to give you an overview of what we call next generation of sequencer, just to give you an update, is all the sequencer that provide high throughput sequencing, but in a short reads. And what you may have in your laboratory is either the IOM torrent sequencer, and all the Illumina's sequencer belong to the second generation of sequencer. So from the Miniseq to the NovaSeq. So here, for instance, you know, in Newfoundland, we use actually actively the MySeq, the Miniseq, and the NovaSeq, same in Singapore. And these actually are sequencers that we call second generation of sequencers. So there were actually a few generations of sequencers, as I mentioned. So the first one was the Sanger style, so we call that the classic sequencer. Then the first next generation of sequencer was the Roche 454, and then come the solid ABA solide, and what we call the next gens, and also the Helicos. So, for instance, in Japan, Riken Institute, a long time ago, they use a lot of the Helicos, which was a bit more advanced, and that's why we call that the 2.5 generations. But unfortunately, both of the sequencers now disappear, and Illumina now trust the market. And now we come to the third generation of sequencer with two brands, so the PacBio and the Nanopore. So this is what I call next generation, so third generation of sequencer. So an update, quick update about the second generation of sequencer. So it produces short reads, piece of DNA that runs from 75 to 250 base pair in a high throughput. So depending which sequencer you are going to use, you can throughput 1 million to 5 billion of this small fragment of DNA. And the way that it works is that it does not actually sequence the entire fragment that you put in the library, but it sequences only the extremity of this fragment. So most of the time we optimize the library, the DNA library to range to be around 500 base pair. And what the sequencer is doing is just sequence the first 150 base pair, or I mean, depending what library you use, on both sides of your DNA string. And then the next stage is to align this read. So this is a different fragment is what you give to the sequencer, and read is what the sequencer gives to you, is just the extremity. These reads are mapped to a reference genomes to find the correct locations. And then we can actually, when you map all the reads, this is how you rebuild the puzzle. So sequencing, using this technology is actually cutting the genome and rebuild a huge puzzle. So if we want to do that very, very properly, it's really computationally demanding because it's actually complicated, and particularly when you have repetitive elements. So imagine that you have a puzzle with the same shape, same color, so it's really difficult to find where this puzzle, where this piece actually goes into this puzzle. And also it's rely on the reference genomes. And you will see that the reference genomes that we use is not actually a reference genomes that is applicable to all ethnical groups, to all individuals, because it was mainly built on Caucasian genomes. And we do see that between an individual, and this is what we see when we study Asian genomes, that we find a lot of structural variants that are not pathogenic, but just polymorphic, which belong to the ethnical group. So very quickly, the way that second generation works, it's required, as I said, reference genomes. And the protocol is that you have your individual genome, you fragment these genomes, then you give this fragment to the sequencer. The sequencer identifies each nucleotide within this fragment, and then you align that to a reference genomes. So when you find a read with a mismatch, we consider that as a mutation. And for instance, in this mismatch, you have in genome reference, you have a C, here you have a G, and that is considered as mutation G2C. So when you have a short read, so for the second generation sequencer, what you need to do is to reconstruct a very, very complicated puzzle. With the third generation of sequencer, we do have to reconstruct a puzzle, but with less pieces, and which make much more easier to identify the differences between the reference genomes and the genome of interest. And also we can rebuild a genome of reference much more accurate. So unfortunately, the third generation sequencer has also some bias. And here I'm going to show you some differences between second generation and third generation sequencer. So to date, the third generation is not able actually to replace fully the second generations, and we still need both for many reasons. So first of all, the second generations can provide very high throughput reads, but the drawback is that it's short fragment. But one big advantage of the second generation of sequencer is that this is the most accurate technology so far. And as I said, it's very hard to put for very cheap. Whereas the main advantage of the third generation is that it can actually throughput very long reads. So instead of 100 base pair, you can go to kilobase. So for instance, our protocol, we do an average between 6 kb to 10 kb, but the longest that we were able to do in our lab was 400 kb. And you can see on the publication, some people actually were able to sequence much longer than that. The drawback of this technology is that there is a low accuracy, and although the chemistry keep improve, this is nothing comparable to what we have with the second generation of sequencer, where the accuracy is close to 100%. And then we can have a similar genome coverage, but with a lower sequencing depth, which means that if we want to have the same sequencing depth as a second generation of sequencer, we need to pay much more. So the price is per kilobase sequencing is much more higher. So now I'm going to give you an introduction to genetic variations. So we have actually several categories of genetic variations in our in my presentation. So I'm going to present you what is structural variant. So I'm going to focus on the structural variant, but I just wanted to position a structural variant with other genetic variations. So the one that everyone actually is used to see is the single nucleotide variations, or SNV. This is actually just a single nucleotide that changes from the reference genome to the individual which has been sequenced. So it's only one base pair. We see that every 4 to 5 million per genome, and the SNP frequency per genome is a bit more than 1%. Then we have what we call the small insertions or deletions, or in short, indel. Indel, actually, the definition is everything which is inserted or removed from the in a genome, in an individual genome. So for instance, the individual has a 4 base pair deletion here, which is actually in a reference genome. The canonical definitions of insert is everything which is in move, remove or insert, which runs from one base pair to 49 base pair. These events appear every 700 kb to 100 kb per genome. So you see it's a bit more frequent than that. And the last one is the structural variant. So it's a huge family which include big deletion. So everything which is more than 49 base pair, so greater than 50 base pair. It can be also insertion. So it include big indel, in other words, but not only, also duplication. So duplications actually is the insertions of one specific piece of the same genome. So the genome is duplicated, but also inversions and translocations. And very surprisingly, the latest report published during the last few years, thanks to the third generation of sequencing, found that these kind of events occurs in average every 23 kb to 28 kb per genomes. So you can see that structural variants, it's a genomic event that is more occur more often than the indels and the mutations. So this is one of the reasons we were extremely interested in investing in diseases that are known are not known to have a lot of mutations, and we wanted to know if structural variants can play a role in several disorders. So in summary, SNV outnumber structural variant outnumber the SNV, so from 3.4 to 1 in terms of base pair. Structural variants have a larger area of impact in the genomes, and structural variants are less characterized than SNP SNVs, mostly due to the limit and the constraint of the previous technology. So to support that, I just wanted to show you a few publications. So one of them is a publication published in Cells in 2019 when they sequenced different ethnical groups. And what they show over here is that you can see in this bar chart all the different the structural variants across the patients. So when you compare that to the genome reference, and you can see that just a few are shared across all the individuals. Some of them in purple are a major allele, which means that they are present in more than 50% of all the samples, but not all. Then you can see in blue here, some of them are polymorphic. That means that they are present in less than 50%. And some of them are unique. So in light blue, unique to the individual. And you can see that the ones that are more unique here, these two individuals, you see much more structural variants specific to this individual from African descendants. And that actually is due to the fact that the genome reference that we use to assess the structural variant here is mostly done by using Caucasian genome. So, and it does not take into account other ethnical groups, and we need to have actually other filter here to segregate structural variants that are that belong to the ethnical group from structural variants that are purely pathogenic. So we know that structural variant is already involved in many diseases. So this is the case of the Down syndrome, the Turner syndrome, few Mendelian diseases, and neurological disorder, and also a lot of different cancers. And to date, the consequence of the structural variants actually are used for targeted therapies, so for personalized medicines. And this is the case for gene fusion, so the BCR-ABL in CML. So this is a kind of leukemia where we use the amitriptyline drugs. So same when we have these gene implications, so FBT2 in breast cancer. So we use actually a specific drug for that. So when we are able to detect that. And BRCA1 in breast cancer as well. So where we were able to find pathological disorder at the structural variant level, in some cases, we were able actually to design some drugs. And the aim of the tools that we are developing and the aim of the work of my team is to further discover new structural variants in other diseases. So we take as an example the AML, so acute myeloid leukemia, for one main reason. So it's because in Singapore, this is actually a disease that affects a lot of patients. And you can see here, half of the patients are diagnosed by as a normal karyotype. So which means that when these individual patients go to the clinics, when we do a sequencing or when we sequence the genome, we cannot see any abnormality in the genomes. So, and the other half, actually, you can see a few of them have inversions, translocations, etc., etc. So what we did is we took this portion, so almost 50% of the patients, and we resequenced them to see if we were able to find structural variants using the third generation technology of sequencer. In other words, what we wanted to do is to see if the fact that we didn't find anything here at the previous stage is just because of the limitations of the technology and not because the genomes of these patients are normal. And this is what we did is we sequenced these patients with both technology, Illumina with second generation sequencing and Nanopore with long with sequencing, so third generation of sequencing. And we combined both. So basically what we did with the long reads, we wanted also to find insertions, duplication, translocation, deletions, and inversions, everything which is larger than 50 base pair. And we know that the limitations of that is the higher error rate, the lower throughput, and the high cost of sequencing by base pair. So right now, what I'm going to explain you is the result of our discovery, is that we have assessed the MinION sequencer from Oxford Nanopore for whole genome sequencing in a human and particularly in patients. We have developed a reliable and low depth long read variant coding as a bioinformatics tool that lower the cost of the sequencing for Oxford Nanopore sequencers, but it works also on PacBio. And we have identified an AML-associated variant in a clinical sample that we are currently investigating. So basically, one of the reasons we reassess the accuracy of Nanopore is because the previous assessment was done in 2014 and 2015. And this assessment actually are outdated because since then, Nanopore has released new chemistry and new flow cell. And this is one of the reasons we wanted to do that. So what we found is that Nanopore have several errors. So what we call the general error, which are single nucleotide deletions or indels. As you can see here, three nucleotide deletions on base mismatches. So this error actually remains. When we compare that to the Illumina, we don't see that at all with the Illumina sequencer. The main drawback of Nanopore is the homopolymer gaps. So for instance, when you have a homopolymer, so here AAAAA, because Nanopore does not read nucleotide, but it reads 5-mer by 5-mer, the sequencer, I mean the algorithms cannot segregate 5-mer to 6-mer to 10-mer, et cetera, et cetera. And this is the reason why this homopolymer is wrongly assessed. Sometimes you have a gap of 6, sometimes you have a gap of 21, et cetera, et cetera, because this is one of the limitations of this technology. And similarly, that is not limited to homopolymer, but also to dinucleotide repeat. And you can see here when you have these GT repetitive elements, all these regions, and same here, GAGA, the read actually are poorly assessed. So to conclude, this technology is still not reliable for small nucleotide variant calling, but we think that we can still use this technology for large fragment when you know actually the limitations, you can actually filter for that and find interesting results. So in brief, we have assessed different software, so different versions of the software, and we always compare that to Illumina sequencer. We do see that at the very base scaling assessment of using clinical samples, so Illumina is still better, so there is no doubt about that, regardless which technology you use. When we did also some simulations, we found that we were able actually to see what was actually the best software to align. So Minimap, we compare Minimap to SBLASTN and NGMLR. So our software actually, we focus mostly on both Minimap and SBLASTN. And also we did also some QC on the distribution of length. So what was the most optimal length to sequence? So I'm not going to into the detail because here everything has been published. So you will be able to see that on the publication. So what was not published is that, so when we assess the different flow cell, and we see that since 2017, when we first started this project, Nanopore did an incredible effort in increasing the throughput of their sequencer. So with the new flow cell, so the latest one that we use, so now they have actually a new one, the version 10. So that was the version 4.9.4. You can see in terms of number of bases sequences, they from here to here, they multiply almost by five the throughput, which enable us to do a proper whole genome sequencing at a low throughput. And this is what we show here. So with the 2017 versions, with one flow cell, we were able to reach only 1.8 depth of coverage of sequencing. So we can sequence less than two genomes. Then with the 2018 versions, we were able to sequence more than 4x the entire genomes. And now with the 9.4, we with the same cost, we are able to reach more than 11% of the genome. And depending actually the money, the number of pores you have, etc., you can reach now from 10 to 13x of coverage, which is, you will see, enough for a proper structural variant coding. So the cost actually continue decrease. So here, that was actually some cost for what we have done in the past. But roughly, if you want to do this kind of sequencing, it will cost you $1,000 per genome. So what we have done is we have developed a new tool. So this tool is called NanoVar. It's optimized for nanopore, but works for PacBio. And what this tool is doing is taking 1 to 2 microgram of DNA. And then we use actually this pipeline, Minimap. We do the variant read characterizations, and then we reevaluate that with HSBlastN. And our pipeline is looking for the insertions, as I said, tandem duplications, translocation, deletions, and versions. And then we use a neural network, so which is an artificial intelligence techniques to assess the precision, the reliability of these structural variants. And this is where, I mean, this neural network ends with a score of a confidence score. At the end of the day, the tools output actually a few files and figures for the QC. So one of them is these figures which show the confidence. So each dot represents one structural variant. The confidence score, you have that on the y-axis, and on the x-axis, you see the break-end ratio, which represent the heterogeneity level of the structural variant. For instance, if you are here at one, that means that all the reads that has been sequencing has the structural variant. And if you are here at 0.5, that means that only 50% of the reads have the structural variant. So and here you can see that we are able to assess the level of heterogeneity of the structural variants across all the cell populations that we are sequencing. So same here, just an overview of how this neural network is working. So basically, what we do, the neural network actually input features are this one, and everything that you have here in parentheses, number of features for the neural network. So to make it short, we take into account the breakpoint alignment features, which include aligned or unaligned proportions surrounding the breakpoint, the alignment e-value surrounding the breakpoint, et cetera, et cetera. We can take into account also the complex alignment features, which can be the total number of sub-aligned processes by reads, et cetera, et cetera, and also the read depth feature. So how many reads confirm this depth of coverage. And all these, so we have all these components in our network classification, and that allows us to improve the variant coding accuracy, use a lower amount of reads, and lower the cost and the labor. This software has been published last year in Genome Biology and is already accessible online. And we, so if you want to use it and to continue to develop that, everything is available in GitHub, also in Python index package. But if you want that as a full package without any installations, you can actually just copy what we have in Bioconda, and everything will be on it. So we have benchmarked NanoVar against other software, and with 4x to 12x, so with homozygous and heterozygous simulated dataset. And as you can see, in terms of recall and precision, we always reach F1 score greater than 0.9. So which means that in terms of recall and precision, we outperform from far all the other software, as we are here, and you can see all other software are there. And we also compare that with IlluminaSec. And when it comes to structural variants, the second generation of sequencer, so IlluminaSec is here and here, we also outperform that particularly in terms of recall. And that is also true when we are working using heterozygous data sets. So, and we did that with 4x, 8x, and 12x of coverage. And regardless actually how you set up the experiment, Nanova actually provide much more high accuracy and high quality structural variants than existing tools. And the reason why is that existing tools were optimized for high depth of coverage, and Nanova actually is optimized for low depth coverage. And this is the reason why we outperform that when we do that at the low depth of coverage. So when we segregate all these structural variants by families, so duplications, deletions, insertions, translocations, and inversions, we can see that for all these categories, when we plot the F1 score, so this is what you have in this spider plot, Nanova outperforms also all the software, and in terms of structural variants, it also outperforms what we were able to do with Illumina, with high depth of coverage. And you can see that Illumina is not able to find big insertions, and that is expected because by definition, the second generation of sequencer rely on our reference genomes. And if the sequence is not in the reference genome, all these insertions won't be able to be brought to light because they are not in the reference genomes. And this is the reason why the F1 score here is close to zero. It's just because this the short read sequencing is not optimized for long insertions. And this is one of the reasons we outperform that. So we do that very well in homozygous and heterozygous in a heterozygous setup. So we have tested that on patients. So two AML patients, we have found several structural variants here. So here I just highlighted a few of them. So we just random pick some structural variant and did some molecular biology validation. So, and we choose different scores and different break-in ratio. What you can see first is that our break-in ratio score, so when you go from here to one, from 1 to 8, really, recapitulate the heterogeneity. And you can see that in this plot. When you have only one, when the structural variant is present in all cells, you have only one band. And more the score decrease, more you will see the a second band. So the intensity you see of the blot correlate very well with the score that we assess here. So which means that some structural variants actually are homozygous, some of them are heterozygous. We can validate that, and the score that we predict is in concordance with what we were able to validate. So just to give you a figure of the different, how a structural variant can be characterized by the different technologies. So with the nanopore, as you can see here, we have a deletions of 500 base pair deletions. We were able to find actually very well the boundary of these deletions with a very long read. So here you can see we have a read of more than 15 KB. When you have with the second generation of sequencing, you are able actually to see very, very small reads, and it's a bit more tricky. So here we have aligned that against it here. So just to show the differences. And then with the Sanger sequencing, which is the first generation of sequencer, the only thing that we can do is validate the breakpoint. So you need to know exactly where the breakpoint is. And this is what we have done here. So we have applied that to a larger cohort of leukemic patients. So as I said, our aim was to look at only normal patients. So we have sequencing a bunch of normal patients, so 11 in total as a first trial. As a positive control, we also sequence some patients with non-structural variants. So for instance, here, a translocation between the chromosome 8 and 21. And then as a negative control, we also sequenced normal donors. So what we learned from there is the first thing is that there is an inconsistency coverage across sample due to the technology advancements. So when we compare what we have done in 2017 and what we have done now, we can see the depth of coverage actually did increase dramatically. And when we see, we correlate the depth of coverage against the number of variants, you can see that when you are you are less than the depth of coverage actually is less than six, you the amount of variant is quite low. When you reach a depth of coverage more than six, so here it's between seven and eight, you the level of structural variant saturate. So this graph shows us that to have a comprehensive landscape of the structural variants, we need to reach at least, let's say, eight. So this is what we recommend, 8x of coverage. And here you can see that from 8x to 12x of coverage, the amount of structural variant does not increase. So you have actually a plateau here that, that is reached when you have a 8x of coverage. So what we were able to find in this panel of patients is that the great majority of the structural variant that we found were deletions, so 43%, then insertions, so big insertion, big deletions, following by duplication. So duplication is a subfamily of insertions, actually. And then very small amount of inversions, only 1%, and some structural variants, translocations, 7%. So we were able actually to validate, to find what the clinical cytogenetic laboratory did. So for instance, all the structural variant found by the cytogenetic actually were found very precisely with our technology. And we were also able to see the prevalence of the structural variants across all the cohort of individuals that we saw. And as you can see here, just a few of structural variants are shared with everyone. And the great majority of structural variants are the one that we call the major. So major is present in more than 50%, which suggests that this structural variant actually is not pathological, but probably a structural variant present in the ethnical group. And this is the reason why we found that in the normal populations. Same for the blue one. So only actually a few structural variants here are found. So what you see here at singleton, so which are unique to the patients. And we are currently trying to work on bioinformatics tools, which will help us to rank and prioritize the structural variants according to the fact if they are if they have a high potential of pathogenicity or not. For instance, if they are close to a genes that are known to be involved in a disease, etc., etc. So when we go deeper into the annotations, we can see that 40% of the structural variants affect protein codings. Some of them non-coding RNA, and you see 43% actually are in an intergenic region, so an annotative regions. When we zoom into the protein codings, the majority of these structural variants are in the intron, so just a few in the exon. So we can actually look further on this small fraction to see if this actually can lead to a disease or just provide an advantage to the to this specific group of populations. And then what we show also here is that some of structural variants also occurs on repetitive elements. So and that's occurs in all categories of repetitive elements. And when we look, we compare that to the non and the catalog variants. So the great majority of them, 80% overlap a variant which has been already described. And what we have shown here in this cohort, 10% of them are variants that are never catalogued before. And I'm going to finish my presentation with one example that we were very interesting. So which is a variant present in an intron in the DCC gene. So you have an amplification here, and this amplification is specifically to AML. We don't see that in a normal. When we go deep in this sequence, what we have shown is that this amplification actually is actually an insertion of a sign element. So this is a repetitive element here, and with a very well known insertion mechanism, so which we call the target site duplication. So you have actually these two sites which are duplicated in a genome of the patients, and that hosts this sign element. So what we think is that with this new technology, we are able also to trace the transposons that jump into the genomes, and then we can also study how what is the implications of this transposon insert into the genome. So what we are so why we are interested in this gene? So DCC is called DCC because I mean it's meant for deleted in colorectal cancer. It encodes for an adrenin1 receptor. This DCC is also associated with normal hematopoiesis. So that actually for us was a smoking gun because you don't see this in normal patients, but you see that with leukemic patients. So, and this is one of the reasons we are investing in that. And DCC expression found is found to be absent in some subtype in AML. So which we suppose our hypothesis is that these insertions may affect the expressions of these genes. So in summary, I show you actually two kind of results. So some results there are from a dry lab, so the bioinformatics one, some from my molecular biology labs. And on a dry lab, what we conclude is that despite the high error rate of the nanopore technology, we found actually this technology very adequate when you reach a depth of coverage of, let's say, more than 11x. To study long structural variant. We have developed an accurate low-depth third generation sequencing long read variant caller called Nanova, which is available, and we are working now on a new version.
Sorry to interrupt you. Could you finish?
Yes. So, and then we found that we work that. On AML, and we found that this technology can be very useful for a disease that doesn't have many known genomic aberrations. And this technology is able actually to highlight genomic aberrations that were not detectable by a previous technology. So I just want to acknowledge all my team, particularly the people who were involved in this project. So Tam Chen Yong and Jeff Woodlands. And also, so the one that I presented before, also my international collaborator from Paris and Singapore, and also from Canada, and all the funding agency. Thank you for your attention.
Okay. I have just one question, which was transferred to me by Oleg Gusev. So the question is, Toati, I like the tools for low coverage analysis. Do you feel it is ready to go to clinic in cost-effective manner?
So what we are doing right now is we are assessing that, and a few other clinics in Europe are doing that. So what we try to do is to compare what we have with this with a cytogenic. The first result are very encouraging, and it at least can replace the cytogenic assay. And we are actually now, so we have sequencing just a few dozen of patients. We need much more to do that. And we were focusing only on AML. So now we are doing that in other cancer, like colorectal cancer. And all primary data that we have generated say yes. And I am extremely confident also because the chemistry of nanopore is keep improving, and the cost also decrease over the years. So what I can forecast is that in, let's say, 2 years from now, we will be able actually to use that in a clinic very efficiently.
Okay, thank you.